Very good. Very good. Well, thank you all for this opportunity to tell you a little bit about our service, SurfDrive. Let me start by telling you a little bit about myself. My name is Jean-Marie de Boer. I am from Amsterdam, the Netherlands. I've been working in the internet industry since 1995, so that's quite a while already. Initially, I did a lot of work as a developer and a sysadmin. I guess it's called DevOps now, but at the time, well, that name still had to be invented. And I did a lot of PHP development, so I kind of saw the whole advent of the professionalization in that field and the advent of frameworks and things like that. And then I moved on more towards system administration and system architecture. And the last 5 years, I've been working at SURF as a specialist. And in my direct team, there is three other engineers with whom we run a number of services. So SURF, what is SURF? Well, the tagline is the Collaborative Organization for ICT in Dutch Education and Research. So we are the Dutch NREN. Jos Poortvliet already mentioned the term. The National Research and Education Network. So in practice, that means we are a not-for-profit cooperation. And we have about 100 members. And the members are the Dutch universities, higher education, academic hospitals, research institutes. So that's the area that we are operating in. So we don't provide commercial services. As a matter of fact, we are even prohibited from competing with commercial entities, which is logical because, of course, we are government sponsored, government funded. So that would give us an unfair advantage. And there are about 100 of these members that are connected to SURF as a corporation. As SURF, we provide a wide portfolio of services. Which I guess you could put in three main categories. Network, so this is fast network connections between the institutes. That's light paths, stuff like that. There's a licensing model, it's not on the slide, but there's also a section of the organization that provides like software licenses, stuff like that to educational institutes. And we do a lot of compute and storage services that we offer to our members. For instance, we run the Dutch National Supercomputer. The new version, the new supercomputer was actually just launched a few weeks ago. And we provide storage. And the storage goes from, like, let's say, small storage for individuals to also a petabyte scale storage for institutes like CERN. Historically, there were three separate entities in what is now SURF. SURF Market, which is the licensing part. SURF Net, which obviously is the does all the network stuff. And SURF SARA, which used to be SARA, which is the compute center. I used to work for SURF SARA since the beginning of this year. This has all been consolidated into a single entity, just called SURF. And the oldest of these entities dates back to 1971, so it has been around for quite a while. So moving on to SurfDrive. SurfDrive started in 2014. At the time, and I think this is a problem that many institutes or maybe people who are present in this talk will recognize. Institutes said, okay, our researchers, they're sharing all this data. We have no idea how they're sharing it. They might be putting it in Dropbox. They might be putting it on Google Drive. They might be putting it on some Microsoft storage system. We have no idea where the data goes. And also, you know, governance is a question. Also, when you put data in these, well, they're called public clouds, but I prefer to call them commercial clouds. There is the issue with license, with ownership. So they needed a solution for that. At the time, several software stacks were researched that could provide this service. And at the time, the decision was made for OwnCloud, which was version 6 at the time. So the goal, well, as stated here, is of course the easy and safe sharing of data in an on-premise solution where the data is actually stored in a data center owned by a corporation, which is in itself owned by the institutes that use it. And one of the goals was that people would not be able to share data within their own institute, but also across the landscape of institutes in the Netherlands and even beyond. And as such, it becomes an enriched personal storage. So it's not just storage, but it has a lot of extra features that add value to the user's experience. And I'll get back to that in just a moment. So by now, of the roughly 100 institutes, 59 are connected to ServDrive directly. We have over 66,000 users. Each user has a 500 gigabyte quotum. Over the years, we have enlarged the quotum again and again. And by now, we have about 1 petabyte of data stored on our storage systems in about 750 million files. And I think this puts us among the larger OwnCloud installations worldwide, let's say. We still see quite a bit of growth. You know, we have about 850 gigabytes of data added every day. And on average, we still have 21 users every day that come into the system. And then you see there a little statistic that I'm somewhat proud of myself. As you can see, we have an availability of 99.996%. This is outside of some occasional maintenance windows. And I don't want to blow my own horn too much, but I think, you know, for a team of just 4 people to run this service on this scale and have this kind of availability, it's something we're quite proud of. So just as an indication, or a bit of a nice graphic, you can see here the growth of users from the beginning until pretty much today, until just a few months ago. As you can see, even though we've been around for quite a few years now, the growth in users is still pretty much a direct line. You can see it's slightly maybe starting to slope down a little bit. You can see we're still growing, which is in a way surprising, because we thought, well, at some point we must have covered most of the landscape, most of the institutes must be connected. And I think it's actually good to mention that we provide the services provided not to all students, but just to, let's say, employees of the institutes. What's also interesting to see is that the number of unique logins per day, which is over 10,000. And that does mean that of these 60,000 plus users, actually most of them are active. It's not that we have a whole bunch of users that are just in the system but no longer log in. No, the service is being used quite actively. Well, here you see the data storage. As you can see, that's also still growing at the same rate. You can also see where we went to 500 gigabytes, and some people woke up, because there the rate in which we ingest data is actually gone up. So all this looks like for the years to come, we still have a good place, and the service is apparently really really well liked by our users. So I mentioned before that we have what we call enriched storage, and I also mentioned it's OwnCloud. Now, I guess most of you here know OwnCloud, but just a little bit about it. So it's not just file storage, it's what you call enterprise file sync and share. So you cannot just store your data, but also share it with the other users. Sharing is not only done within the institute, as I said before, but also it's crossing boundaries. And this is becoming, in the last years, more and more important, also on a European scale. I mentioned it earlier in the discussion that we had, all the European meshes, Gaia X, all these services are being developed. Federation, which is becoming more and more mature. Federated identity sharing, searching on a global scale. So these are all things that are that we either have already or are working towards. In addition, there's a lot of apps and integrations that are directly beneficial to the user experience or their use of the service or working with their data. So a simple one is, for instance, audio video players, things like Draw.io, a Markdown editor, Jupyter notebooks we are providing for some customers. There's workflows. And of course, and this is of course what we all want to hear about, is Collabora Online. So the Collabora Online integration we've had for 4 years now. It's a highly available setup using HAProxy, which means we have no downtime for upgrades, unless, you know, I think there's been a few instances where there was a major upgrade, but the minor upgrades that we do, we can all do them in production. So that 99.997% also goes for Collabora. It's then, if we look at the usage numbers, it's the number two app after the PDF viewer. So I looked up some of the operations that we have logged over the years. And I could see that over those 4 years, we have had over 2.5 million operations done via Collabora Online. 2 million save operations, 250,000 read operations. Now, to put this into perspective, there is an autosave function in Collabora Online. So when you are working on your document, you're not going to lose your edits because it's saved for you automatically. So this is going to have some effect on those save operations. So we still see 5,000 per day. I think this is probably the other way around. It's probably 5,000 reads and 1,000 saves. But it does show the services being really, really actively used, and it's really providing a lot of value for our users. And we are now transitioning to having Collabora Online as the default for PDF. So we've been enabling the secure view option that Patrick Meyer also mentioned earlier. And from that point on, Collabora Online will just, you know, simply be the number one app that our users use. So, of course, we're not standing still. We have some current and future developments. One on the top running in three data centers. I'll just go to another slide with a little bit more information about this. Initially, our service was hosted in one single data center with an offsite backup, the Amsterdam Data Tower. But of course, in the long run, this could provide problems if some disaster happens in that one data center. So that's why we had a long-standing requirement or wish to move to three data centers, which we have done mostly, where like I think 80% of the stuff is being moved in production, I should say. So we move all the servers around without any downtime. ISO 27002 says the data center should be at least 5 kilometers apart. Well, they are, as you can see here from this map, is Amsterdam. And as we've all seen with the three data center of OFH, moving them a bit further apart is quite a good idea. So this will be a fully redundant setup where we could lose one data center completely, and we would still have enough processing power and also redundancy in data to be able to rebuild everything. And the setup will become active, so there's no failover as such, because failovers, they fail and they fail over and over and over. So rather we go for an active setup where we know everything is working all the time. Then we are quite obviously, as OwnCloud users, we are looking at OTSIS. Patrick also mentioned a little bit about this. This will go hand in hand with a transition towards Kubernetes. Right now, our orchestration is based on Docker Swarm, on those areas where we have container orchestration for our own cloud setup. We will move to OwnCloud Web as a front end. At that point, we will start testing the new Collabora integration, which I think is either ready or almost ready. And then we are working towards the integration in all these European in European meshes and larger federations with the CS3 community, where I think I may have met some of you in the past.
Indeed.
And that's my presentation for today.
Well, lovely. Thanks, Jean-Marie. And it doesn't leave much time for questions, but if there are any, I have one, which is this. How is your hardware provisioning for Collabora Online versus, you know, OwnCloud versus storage and that sort of thing? What does it look like server-wise?
We actually run the Collabora service as virtual machines. Mm-hmm. So we have hardware with where multiple, I think we have about 6 VMs now behind the HA proxy, which that's what allows us to do this rolling upgrades, if you will. So we can just basically drain some of the backends, and then once they are empty, we can update those, then drain the other ones. And well, this is getting quite technical, but we mainly use Foreman and Ansible, and so we do automate all our provisioning.